Welcome to the Strategy Superpowers podcast. Your co-hosts are Chris Gibbons and myself, Ben Lowrey. Chris is the founder of the Incubator Business Group, and Chris partners with many different businesses in order to rework their entire business strategy and help them to grow to new levels of profitability that they have not seen before. Chris also has an accelerator program, which is a 24-month program in which he works with people in order to grow their business. And also, we're interested in having guests on a podcast. So if you have questions about business, you're welcome to submit your questions. We'll answer them. And if you'd like to be a guest on the podcast, then email us and we'd love to have you on the show. And so, welcome, Chris Gibbons. Welcome to the call. How are you doing, Chris?
Cool. How are you?
I'm looking forward to talking about business with you. I consider you one of my business friends. You're somebody who loves business, loves talking about business, and I'm the same. So how's it going?
I do. Yeah, cool. I think we could pick any topic. I like to solve problems specifically. I think if this goes well, we should carry on. We've talked about it. So maybe this could be the start of a focused business podcast.
Yeah, and we've talked about getting different guests on as well in your ecosystem of what you do, you deal with a lot of different people in a lot of different businesses, right? So I guess there's a lot, you know, there's all kinds of people with different stories to tell.
Different stories to tell and just loads of things to learn from them. I love the thing, when I was a business coach, the thing I always felt was I had to be the one with the answers all the time. But since I took that hat off, it's been good because there's just so much to learn and, it just makes life interesting. Now, I can't imagine having a life where you didn't have to stretch yourself and learn something new every day.
Oh yeah, completely. Now, I know we did an episode a couple of months ago, but let's presume that people listening to this, you know, don't know what you do. So you said you were a business coach and now you're doing something different. So what essentially is the difference?
Well, we started an incubator, so, and it's called Incubate with no U, so INQBATE .business. We've basically got three products. One is a co-working space that we're growing. We're looking for some new sites at the moment where people can come and hang out in our environment and run their business, set up their business. Maybe they've already in a business, but they just want a smaller place or a quieter place to work or a different location for a small office. So a bit like serviced offices was a few years ago, but much more geared around growth businesses. So we're very careful about who we bring into that. We have an accelerator program, which is for businesses who typically, it's either for a startup, but typically for businesses who have been running for a while and want to scale, but are struggling with their marketing. It doesn't seem to, the marketing might be hit and miss. And the idea of the program is that we redesign their business model so that the marketing becomes easy. And that launches into the third product, which is a partnership program or even an investment from us where we actually partner and become part of businesses and go on the journey with them to grow their business.
Right. Hey, like in all the years that you've been doing the business coaching and everything, how many different businesses have you dealt with or interacted with or, you know, given advice to in one form or another?
Hundreds. I don't know.
Hundreds.
I mean, I can't think of, I mean, everything from IT businesses to car windscreen businesses to karate businesses, fashion, manufacturing, photography. I mean, I think business is business. Once you understand, or at least what we do is you know, the bits that we focus on, the bits that I've sort of that I'm most interested by are the same anyway. It's not about actually what the business does. It's about figuring out the strategy, and the process is the same in anything. So, I mean, yeah, we could pick an industry and I'm sure I can think of someone we've got some history with.
What's your most memorable or proudest sort of intervention, you know, that really sticks out in your mind?
Ah, oh, blimey. I mean, one of our biggest, one of my favorite businesses that we've got, we're actually a partner in the business as well now, is so Jenny started her business about 10 years ago and eventually ended up on Dragon's Den pitching for some investment, and she didn't get it. And we, one of our team saw the episode and decided that she had a few good things in her business, and it would be worth giving her a call. So they gave her a call and said, do you want to have a chat? So we did have a chat, and that was the business name is Gemius, but there were two or three actually at the time separate businesses. One was a baby product business, one was a business for helping produce sensory products so a lot of people with typically with autism or some sort of sensory processing disorder have what they call sensory processing difficulties, which basically means they find chewing or fidgeting or playing with and using sort of sensory squeezable products, those sorts of things, to help them sort of get through the day. The people we're helping in that business often spend days chewing through clothes and their skin, even. It's horrible. Mm. So that's a really good one, because the business was good, growing, getting some good attention, helping some lot of people. But the challenge was it was a product business. And with any product business, especially at the low end of the market, like with a product that's a low cost product, you just have to count down the days or the months before someone from China comes and copies you with exactly the same thing, right. Even if you've got some sort of protection on the product, it's almost impossible to defend anything like that properly. So we've basically focused on that business and turned it into a community-based marketplace. So the business went from having its business model based around building and designing and shipping a good product to the business being focused on helping someone with sensory processing challenges live a normal life, or get through or be able to get through life easier than they would before. And so what we did, we created education products, we created a community where they would help, where people can help each other. We've got podcasts, we've got a massive team of people who help new people who come into the community, and by helping them, one of the things that they also need is products. So the products are kind of the secondary part of, we sort of sell the products to fund the other part of the business now.
Right. And, so you change the emphasis.
Yeah. And it's sort of, that's basically sort of sums up what we do in Incubate. It's finding the actual problem. I was listening to something the other day. I can't remember what it was. Might have been one of Seth Godin's books or something. I think it was. I think it was a Seth Godin podcast or something. And he was saying that this is what we've been doing for a while. If you've got a drill company, you don't sell a drill. No one wants a drill, or they don't even want the hole. So you don't even sell the hole. They want to put a picture up. And actually, they don't even want the picture that's on the wall. They want the feeling of walking into the room and seeing their loved ones on the wall. Mm. And that's, you know, you're talking about a drill company, and I think it's really, it's really uncommon to talk to a business that understands actually what business it's in. And that's one of the biggest surprises to me. Even with bigger businesses have been in business for a long time. Typically, if they had it, they lose it after a while, because it can change over time, especially with technology and, you know, how you might deliver that. Like, just look at Airbnb or Uber or any of the big stories in that in sort of the disruption of any of those markets. Those businesses only exist because the big players that were there 10 years ago didn't change their business models fast enough to keep up with what was possible with tech, you know?
Yeah. I relate to what you're saying. I can't remember if we said this last time, but like with handstand workshops, I never really think they want to learn handstands. Like, I figure people want to feel better about themselves, and you know that they've decided in their mind they want to be more physically able, feel better about their body, feel stronger, you know, that kind of thing. But it's really like the bottom line is they just want to feel better about themselves. And so I always keep that in mind with what I do, you know, like that's
yeah, you know. So why do they want to feel better about themselves? Like, who's coming to your workshops?
Well, it's mostly yoga people and yeah, mostly. I mean, so, you know, general fitness people, gymnastic people and stuff, but they're quite often, let me think about this now. They're quite often a little anxious and a little timid, and it's almost like they're coming for a confidence boost as much as anything, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, that's why they get into yoga.
Yeah.
That's why they're part of that whole scene. So those people, anyone who participates in anything like that, yoga, handstand workshops, I don't know, Girl Scouts, anything that's sort of a community thing, people are going there because they need. You would never find me in a group workshop because I'm just not a people person in that way. You know, I love people and I've got some, I'm happy to chat to my friends and one-on-one, I'm fine, but I would never actively seek out a group of new people to just go and hang out with. Mm. It's just not part, you know, but those, so there's something in that as well, isn't there? They're looking for a community or some validation from,
community.
I'm not sure what it is.
Community, yeah. And connection's a big part of it as well, for sure. Definitely right. With classes. Yeah, definitely with yoga. I think that's a big, I mean, not for everybody, but for a lot of the people that do it, they want to feel part of a community. Yeah, for sure.
Mm. But it's also, I think one of the things I've learned is that it doesn't actually matter. Sometimes we can sit here and I've done this when we're meeting new businesses, and I hear them sort of getting into brainstorming mode and trying to figure out what it is. So we're trying it now when we're talking about your handstand. What we're trying to understand, what is the reason people go to my handstand workshops? But actually, you could choose the reason that they come to your handstand workshops. Mm. So you could run a handstand workshop class and I could run one in the same town, in the same gym even. Actually, there's no way I could run one, but you know what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And your goal might be to bring in, or your classes for people who want to learn handstands because they want to get more confident so they can get a better job. And all of your marketing and conversation and the people who you attract and the way that the branding looks and the first words you use when they walk into the room and what you ask them to tell their friends, all of that is about, you know, I'm going to teach you how to do handstands so that you become more confident, which will allow you to go and get your new job.
Yeah.
But I could go do the same thing. Technically, the handstands might be the same thing, but for people who wanted to, I don't know, go pick up girls on the weekend or something.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. Yeah, totally. Like within what I do, like for example, there's a gymnastics club and they've got a different emphasis, and they're very much like hardcore gymnastics conditioning, and they're focused on like core conditioning and strength conditioning, and like it's kind of very serious. It almost like in the context of like working people towards like competitive gymnastics, and so
right.
They might be teaching handstands, but I'm selling a completely different thing. I'm selling like feel good, fun, playful, have a good time, you know, kind of experience. But yeah, right. I totally see what you're saying. We're both selling the same thing, but we're selling different things,
totally different things. But the thing is, people don't decide. They say we do handstands, and we can, you know, you ask a question to a handstand business owner and you say, well, what, you know, who are you looking for, what business are you in? And they say the handstand business. They don't say I'm in the business of helping people get better jobs through handstand workshops.
Mm.
And because they don't decide, all their marketing is hit and miss. Their growth is hit and miss. They don't have that really clear hook. They're almost afraid of hanging up a sign and committing to that sort of direction, because they'll lose the other group of people who might not be looking for the job. But the every single time that you do that, you may miss a few people, but you'll get so many more of those people who you are targeting that it doesn't matter.
Right. Yes, yeah. That makes sense. So when you deal with a new business for the first time, are you like asking yourself, like, you know, what are we really selling here? What's the overriding thing that we're trying to accomplish? It, like the big picture goal?
Yeah, that's the only thing we do. Yeah, that's the first thing. That's the first step. In fact, just having some conversations about it now. I'm not sure whether I started this conversation when I spoke to you last, but we are probably about to, I can't really give you the names, but we're probably about to start a new business with a photography business. Mm. And a similar thing, like over the years, they've done anything that's photography, wedding photographies, portraits, babies, this, that, you know, all of it. And the challenge with that is it's really hard to market that because nobody wants a photographer.
Mm.
They want the thing that you, the memory, the thing. So the big thing that they've had a lot of success with, which is where the whole focus is, it was actually happening before we got there, but we've really honed it in the last few months, is baby photography. And we've turned it, we've turned the model into basically a one product business. There's only one product this business does now, but the marketing results have been phenomenal in the last few weeks. They've gone from lead cost has come right down. They've gone from booking 10, maybe appointments, 10 bookings a month to 45, 55, something like that, in that sort of region.
Right.
And they haven't really started yet. We haven't actually started working with these guys yet. And that's another thing we do. So we just, when we find someone who's interested in partnering with us, if they're interested in the end program, which is where we take a part of the business or we become partners, we tend to spend 2 to 3 months working with them for no charge, just to get to know each other and see if we can help and have an impact on the business without either of us committing. Because if you go into partnership with someone, you have to be pretty sure that they are, you like each other, you know?
Mm.
So...
Right. Yeah. So what you do is genuine long-term partnership. It's not a case of paid $19.99 up front and, you know, sort of, it's nothing like that. It's not like a salesy package. It's a very genuine business partnership you're looking for.
Yeah. 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 Well, I mean, I've sold training and programs and things in the past, and I totally understand the model, and it makes sense in a lot of cases when you're training on some specific things. But for us, I got out of that business because of the fact that it was always a fee paying relationship is always limited to the last invoice, if that makes sense.
Mm.
And the commitment from both sides in that case is always questionable, I suppose. And I thought it made more sense just to find people to commit to for the long term. Let's find people who want to just go on a journey together. And because of that, we decided to just, in a lot of cases, work with people up front, see if we can get some results. And if after that we still like each other, they're free to walk away if they want. Even after they've got some results, they might walk away. But inevitably they don't, because there's a lot further to go.
Hey, I just had a thought, right? Tell me what you think of this. I got a friend who's knowledgeable about hemp and CBD oil and THC and cannabis, and he knows all about it.
Yeah.
I've been talking with him quite a lot, and he's been talking with me about maybe I could sort of, you know, do a deal with him and like kind of something like what you do, you know, help him with like the marketing strategy, you know, business side of it, something like that. I don't really like the sound of it because I don't understand the legalities with, you know, what's legal, what's illegal. So I haven't really explored it fully, you know, but I was just wondering, what's your gut instinct with the hemp market?
I mean, I'd love to do something like that, because anything that's scary for most people is a really good indicator that someone's going to do really well in it, because it's such a scary thing. even if the rules are clear and simple, because it's a taboo topic. That's why, do you remember, oh, I don't know, 10, 15 years ago, there was a documentary on Channel 4, and it was like a 16-year-old Jewish kid who made millions from porn websites.
Right.
Did you ever see that?
I don't remember that, no.
But he was a kid and he knew about the internet, and there was no one really doing a good job in porn. And he thought, well, I could do a better job. And because it was porn, it wasn't being, you know, at the time, it wasn't making anyone much money, because the people who knew about that stuff weren't touching it. I think probably the same is true now for cannabis and stuff, especially with all the lobbying that's going on. I know in Germany I read the other day that there's plans to legalize it. It's already been legalized for medical use. But they are still going through the process of allocating licenses to growers. And they opened up the process for people to apply for licenses. And I think something like only 10 companies have applied for licenses to grow. And I'm not sure whether that's whether they're only processing 10 or what, but it just seems to me like one of the big barriers is the fear of it all.
Right.
So that's cool.
Hey, you gave me the exact opposite answer I was expecting. I thought you were going to say, stay the fuck away from that.
Yeah, why?
I don't know. I don't know. I thought that was what you were going to say.
No, do it. Oh, shit, hang on. I've lost my
All right, Graham, if you're listening, we need to talk.
can't hear you. Lost my headphones. One sec.
It's all right.
Right.
Yeah.
Hello?
Yeah.
I got you back. Yeah. Oh, I mean, I don't know anything about this guy. I don't know, you know, I don't know anything about it either. So I'm not saying jump into it, but I just think that there's nothing to be scared of there.
Isn't it?
I mean, do your research, but of course.
Yeah. That's interesting, isn't it? I came at that with a kind of opposite belief. I kind of presumed it was a load of, you know, a load of risk and a load of problems and a bad idea. And yes, it surprised me to hear you say the opposite.
Well, this is one of so that is my view, but I think I am naturally attracted to solving problems and complicated problems. I was talking about this with the team in the office. We've got some really good projects that are on ice that we know how to deliver, that we can make some good money with, and we could get them running a few weeks. Some businesses that have been there for a while, we've done the work on them. But at the moment, the team are really occupied on two or three other projects, which are way more complicated, bringing us in hardly any money. And the potential's good for the long term, but it doesn't outweigh the potential of these easier businesses. But that's just my nature is just to try to solve complicated problems. So it's not necessarily the right thing to do. It's just because I'm happier doing that.
I think, you know. How do you deal with delegation and partnership? Like, because I guess on one end of the scale, you could have a situation where you're afraid to delegate anything because the business person feels that only they know best, kind of thing. And then on the other end, I guess there's people that you kind of lose control and aren't in control of what's going on in their business. So how do you deal with that?
I've never had a problem with delegating. I think what I've had a challenge with is vetting the people I delegated to well enough. So I think I had the opposite challenge. I've always been very quick to, since I was about, I don't know, 22, I saw myself as the finished article in business when I wasn't, if that made sense. In my head, at least, I would walk down the street and I would be finished. Does that make sense? Like I learned a lot from some really amazing business people and people like Tony Robbins, and I applied it all so well that in my head I was already a superstar CEO.
Right.
And that made it so some of those big things that, like delegating, I was probably too quick to do. And because I thought, like, I was that in my head, but I didn't have the experience to actually vet the right people, to follow through with managing them. So I don't think delegation was the challenge for me. It was management. And that's, I think, well underrated.
So do you mean to say, like, you were too willing to kind of sort of do deals and partner with people and give out tasks?
Yeah, right. Too free, exactly.
So you could have done with tightening up and pulling back a little bit.
A lot, yeah. And I probably still could, yeah. But we've got a lot better at it. And I've bought, you know, people. I think one of the things that's really helped over the last 5 years is since we became a bit more stable in business and weren't sort of rushing to grab a deal to earn a bit more money, that's helped a lot, because it's allowed me to really form good relationships with key people in the team who basically take care of everything. I don't do any, you know, that's taken a long time to do. I think people try to jump to that step. Oh, my phone's going. It's gone. That people try to jump to that step. They sort of sat there in their one person businesses, where I was too, talking about delegating and managing and outsourcing and that sort of stuff, when they've not got enough resources to hire a bookkeeper to make sure that's off their plate completely. Mm. Or, you know, so it's not, you have to go step by step, but I think the way I would advise anyone who's got a small business with just themselves or maybe two people in it is to start thinking about, the first thing to start delegating is the work itself, the things that you get paid for. You can, if you're the person who has to turn up to the meeting to earn the money, then the business is limited to the number of hours you can turn up to those meetings or those events or make those widgets or whatever it is that you do. So the very first thing, contrary to what most businesses end up doing, that you should delegate is the actual work itself. What most people do is they hire a salesperson or a marketing person because that's going to get them more work.
Right.
But that's the hardest thing to do. So does that make sense?
So they stay in the position of fulfilling the service themselves and delegate everything else. But really, they should be thinking about getting someone else to actually deliver the service.
Yeah, again, we're kind of given all of these sweeping statements that it's just impossible to say in every circumstance that's the right thing to do.
Yeah.
Let's say that you are, let's say that you're Gordon Ramsay. That's a bad example because he did set up a business. Let's say you just love doing handstands. That's the thing. That's what drives you. And that's what you want to do forever. In that case, carry on doing handstands. But assuming you actually want to build a business and have something, then yes.
Yeah. That makes sense. Yeah. The other thing I was thinking of asking you, have you ever done a deal? Have you ever had to raise capital as part of your things that you do, like from an outside investor?
No, I mean, I tend to avoid anything like that.
Yeah.
I'm not comfortable. I've never done any deals in that field. So I've always been more comfortable in the small business area. It's what I love. Maybe I say it's what I love because I've not done anything massive. Mm. But I tend to like businesses sort of under 10 million, I would say. And that to me is still quite a small business, as in the owners are still there. We've got some partnerships with some bigger businesses, but the ones that we get involved with, I think at that level, we would look to stop our involvement or sort of exit slowly or take a seat on the board, but not do so much work. Because I've not done anything, I've not been involved in bigger businesses than that, really.
And it's like, I think I'm probably, we've got a similar nature like that. Like, I don't like I prefer the idea of like growing something organically just by applying sort of good ideas. I don't really like the idea of going and borrowing money and, you know, spending all that money on a load of kit. And it, like, I think I'm naturally averse to that.
Yeah. Brad Sugars, who was the who was is one of my mentors and the founder of the coaching business Action Coach that I was part of for 15 years.
Is that the Australian guy?
Yeah. Huh. He's he used to say, or he probably still does say, that you get the money you need. You get the deals you need. And I think that's been very true for me. And I was talking to him once. I remember, I think it was in the Celtic Manor. There was a conference. No, actually, this was in London, in Paddington. We were sat at the bar and I was talking about earning some more money. And I'd been stuck at about the same level for a while. And I was saying, oh, I want to make some more money. And he said, you get the money you need. And I said, well, I need some more. And he said, no, you don't. And reflecting on that later, many years later, I've realized that he's right. The reason he's earned so much more, he's made a lot of money, is because he needs it in his life, because he has a life, or he's built a life, or he designed his life to require that level of money. So he's had to go and do those bigger deals. And I'm really happy with, we have a great life, don't get me wrong, but I don't need a Ferrari, and I don't feel like it's just not a driver for me.
Right.
And because it's not a driver for me, perhaps I'm certain I'm leaving a lot of money and deals on the table. Maybe if I needed the Ferrari, I would go and do those much easier businesses that are simple, that we know how to run, instead of focusing on these complicated projects. And yes, maybe it's not advice, but I think people need to understand themselves, because I've sort of made peace with that. I like it.
Mm.
I'm happy in this area.
Yeah, it definitely strikes me that you're not just motivated by cold hard cash and bottom line. You know, there's like a almost an artistry, like you said before, the problem solving. There's like an art to it. There's an enjoyment to it, like kind of like a craftsman in a way, like craft in a business. That's what I get from.
Yeah. Yeah, I like building lots of things. I like having a team of people who are having a great life. You know, the team in our business, we've got some really cool rules. Like the team, there's no holiday for the team, there's no working hours for the team. We ask them to tell us how much they want to earn, and then we make a plan with them to try and get them there. And every, you know, all of the financials and all of the plans in the business, the whole team are involved in understanding where we're going, and we make a really good point of that. And that's like, to me, building that and having all these people around us and sort of being the conductor in that is way more exciting than me earning another couple of hundred grand to buy a car, or, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, totally.
Have
you ever...
I feel like I'm talking about me. Go on.
No, it's all right. No, I'm glad you're talking about all this stuff. It's gold, man. Bombs. I was going to ask, have you had any major financial disasters where you've like lost a ton of money and it's been like a real problem, like, you know, almost ruined you? Yeah. Have you had anything like that?
Yeah. Yeah. Big one.
Oh, right. I didn't realize that.
In 2010. The second partnership that we went into, was a roofing business. The guy was working for me at the time, and we were running a big event, and he was a salesman, and he actually came and said, I've got, my old business was a roofing business, and before that I had another business, and I've got this idea of, after this event's finished, using the marketing team to actually generate, to do some digital marketing and then use the team to sell appointments for roof renovations. So we looked at the business and it looked quite interesting. Spray foam roofing. I don't know if you've seen it. Spray foam installation and things like that.
No, I don't know.
It looked quite interesting. And did a bit of research on the guy. And he was actually one of the Fast Track 100 winners for Richard Branson's the Times and Richard Branson's competition, where, you know, there's a picture of him standing there, and this was in his previous business that I heard the story about, and I thought, this guy, no, he's great, let's do this thing. So we did it for a while, and it was going all right. We did I've still got the, I was checking this out with Amy, who still works with me today, and basically runs all of the, she basically runs everything, but she does, she's the financial director basically of the whole, everything we work with. And I was pulling out some files, and I saw her name on some, and it was from that time. And I think within 3 months we did like £500,000 worth of business came from the worth of inquiries came from the digital marketing we did. So we were like, this is going to be great. And we started doing some work, and we partnered with lots of roofing companies, and we were originally selling them some leads, but then we actually started getting involved with some of those. Anyway, long story short, James had a few challenges and ended up disappearing, vanished from sight. no idea where he went. And the money that was in the bank went with him.
Oh, no.
But the worst part was, I mean, he didn't take much money, but what he took was the deposits. He was actually still going out and collecting data, collecting leads and appointments, doing his own ads under our brand, and taking the appointments, taking deposits, and not doing the work.
Oh, right. And so he stitched you up.
Yeah, and we were lucky. We got out, made it clear we were out, clear that we weren't part of the brand. But within weeks, he ended up on, you know, the watchdog.
Yeah.
In Wales, they've got something called the ferret, which is basically the Welsh watchdog.
Okay.
And he ended up on that with a guy following him around. And I was, it was really hard because to know that people are out there, they weren't using my name because we got out before it happened, but it was within weeks of it happening, you know?
Right.
And
did it cost you?
Well, it cost us all of the, yeah, I had to pay back some deposits, quite a lot of deposits that he had taken, and the customer never got the work done. So just we did pay back some of those, but we had to draw the line at some of them. Some of the roofers that had done some work didn't get paid, and I had to pay some of those back. In fact, I didn't have to because it wasn't part of it, but some of them we did.
Was there any, did he get prosecuted in any kind of criminal fraud kind of way?
Honestly, he disappeared. I have no idea. Wow. I tried to track him down. I've tried since to track him down. He's disappeared from the internet. I think he must have changed his name or something.
So
I just don't know where this man is.
So what would you have done differently then? It sounds like you sort of invested, you relied on him, you gave him a lot of trust in order to handle the money that you were sort of...
Yeah, and I think I probably did a bit... I think hindsight is... Yanina would say that I'm too trusting, I think. So that's my wife. So she, and in hindsight, I'm right. She was right. There's just some people that you shouldn't trust. There's something about them that's a bit dodgy that, you know, that, yeah. And he was one of those people.
I mean, would you have done it differently in terms of like the money that was coming in, have it in some kind of way?
I just wouldn't have gone into business with him. I don't think it's any of those details that really matter. I think you could think about all of those things. You could get into the details of all those things, but if someone's going to do something, it'll be the thing that you haven't thought of that they'll do that'll screw it up, if that makes sense.
Right.
So we could give you all of the things that I might have changed detail-wise, but the bottom line is, I knew somewhere that he was probably not the right person to be in business with.
But how can you ever really know fully though? Like, don't you need some like actual mechanisms in terms of like who can write checks and who can access accounts?
Yeah, of course, all of that's there. But I mean, we were both directors of the company and that's all. I mean, there were, you know, it wasn't that he took a lot of cash from the bank. It was the extra deposits and then going out and trading with our name afterwards and putting the deposit, taking the deposits in cash. I mean, there's only so much you can do.
Yeah. At the end of the day, he's the one who stole it, isn't he? Not you, you know?
Yeah. But we did our best to get things back on track with that. But I think you said, how can you really know? Don't you really know? I mean, like, can you think, you must be able to think back to people and relationships and people where you thought you were doing business with them, you were listening to them, you were engaged in with them somehow, but somewhere somewhere, did you really think that this was 100%, you know, or does that make sense? Because you've had some people as well who you've sort of been with, and then...
I mean, I can certainly look back and see where I was naive and like there was red flags that now I would have noticed, but at the time, you know, I wasn't discerning enough to notice the warning signs for sure. But there's like, yeah, I get it. But isn't there just like an element of you know, kind of randomness or bad luck, or you know, someone stitches you up, and I don't know, I'm not sure really.
Maybe I think I every time it happens to me, every time something happens to me like this, nothing like that has happened ever since, but you know, every time a deal doesn't quite work out, I talk about it with Janina, and she references conversations that I've had with her earlier in the relationship where I've said something's not quite right, or I wasn't quite sure, or, you know.
Yeah, there was red flags. Yeah. Well, I think that sometimes when I see people's relationships and like girls get together with guys and it's like, oh yeah, he turned out to be a you know, he was not very nice to me. And I was like, yeah, oh, obviously he was a dick. Like, you know, the red flags were there like from the start. Like, how did you not see them? You idiot. You know, it sort of seems, yeah, it kind of seems obvious in situations like that to me.
Yeah. I think for me, I'm so excited by the possibility of something working, and I'm so optimistic that I tend to ignore those things. Even though I technically know I should listen to my gut, I've heard a ton of people talking about it. I've given it as advice. I've felt the pain of it. I know when I do it, I'm in the moment, I can feel that something's not right, but I'm really good at ignoring it. Or I'm a great salesperson and I sell myself another story. And then at the end, I go back and I think, ah, shit. You know, that I can honestly say that the deals that we've got at the moment, I can't, they're going to be forever. There's just some things what Tony Robbins says it, doesn't he? Some things are for a season, something, and a lifetime, or something. What's that? I can't remember what it is.
Yeah, reasons, seasons, lifetimes.
That's it, yeah. Reasons, seasons, lifetime. And I think they're the businesses that we've got now. I just know some of them for lifetimes, but I couldn't have honestly said that about James and the roofing business,
right,
or a couple of the others that we've lost along the way.
Yeah.
I don't know how to, yeah. Maybe I wouldn't have said the same thing at the time, though. That's
It's tricky, isn't it?
It's hard.
Yeah, that's right. It's like 2020 hindsight vision, isn't it? Yeah, it's hard because with anything, of course, there's always an element of risk and unknown, you know, no matter how, nothing's ever totally certain, is it? You know, with relationships and yeah, I mean, yeah, finding, I don't know where that line is.
Yeah, that's one of the reasons why I love the playing in this area of sort of, we start with businesses, they tend to be sort of $500,000 to $1 million, and then look to get them up beyond that. And there's no cash for involvement from us. It's all about, when we work with people, we want to see quick results and put some money on the bottom line and demonstrate some value really quickly, so that instantly we're up on the deal, if that makes sense.
Right.
And the people we're working with are up on the deal. So everyone, you know, and I think I like that because it does take that sort of money risk side of it out. I suppose the relationship side is always
that's,
there.
But, that's a great proposition for people because, you know, you're proving, you're doing the results, aren't you, for free? I mean, there couldn't be a better proposition. That's as good as it gets.
Well, it's not for free. They've got to work. You know, we've both got to, they've got to work, we've got to work. It's not like, it's not, I think time and the costs of making changes are not free. So if you're working with us and we've got to change some things, those things cost money. We're just not charging like consulting fees, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
But yeah, I mean, it's not for everyone because we're asking for a lot more in the long run than a consulting firm would. We're asking for some of the business in those cases.
Yeah.
that's not the only way we work with people, but that's like the ultimate. That's where
certainly like that business. You know, I like the way you do it and your ethos and the whole feel of it. You know, I think we've probably, me and you have got a similar temperament in many ways. And I do like your approach. I'm quite averse. I'm not like a fast paced sales kind of person. I'm not the kind of person that just tells people what they want to hear just to get money out of them in the moment. You know, that's not my nature either.
No, I did learn to sell pretty well, but it's never paid in the long term, really.
Yeah.
The relationships that I've sold, I can think back to selling sales training, in fact, and you know, you sell sales training, you deliver the sales training, and that's it. But there's no, you know, it's not the same thing as...
Yeah, like a slow burn kind of thing. Yeah, for sure, yeah.
Yeah, the partnerships and the that we do and the work that we do, yeah, that's why we don't have space to take on tons of people. It takes months and months and months, typically sort of 3 to 6 months before we decide to actually work with someone, and we have quite a long process to build up to a deal because of that reason. There's no, everyone's in a rush, you know. This is that, you might like this story actually. In fact, you should probably, I wonder if you could get involved in it. Did I tell you about the guy who owns the building we've got as our co-working space?
No.
Okay. He's 96 years old and he's basically owns most of the town that I live in. And he came, started from nothing. He goes to work every day, fully switched on, super like active and everything. So, we were in the paper about a month ago and they did a whole piece on what we're doing, and he read it and, he wanted to meet me, and I just so happened to pass his office this week. So I popped in and said, look, I'm sure you've got some more space for us or something. I haven't forgotten. I know that you want to see me about it because we are looking for some more space, and he's got some more space and I haven't forgot about it. He says, sit down, young man, sit down. So he says, sit down. And he says, tell me about this business. What is it? Cause he's 96 and I'm thinking, oh God, he's not going to understand it. And you know, so I say, well, you know, so explain the whole co-working concept and bringing people who, you know, who don't want to travel to the city every day, or startups, and creating a culture and having a learning center and training rooms and, you know, the all the stuff that we've got and the coffee area, everything that's sort of fun to be part of. And instantly, like people who are 40, 50 don't get it, but he gets it straight away. Like he's so sharp. And instantly he's like, okay, I've got an idea. And I'm like, what? He's like, can you wait till January? And I said, what do you mean wait till January? I've got an idea. And he goes off and he explains, like, I've got this space here and I will move. He's like, I will move my office so you can have this one because I've got some big projects I want to start next year. And I'm like, this guy is my new hero. And that's like what I can imagine. I want to be like that. You know, he's not, there are people in the world who just, they're just excited by new things. And he's 96 and he's talking about new projects.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. 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 So you're not the kind of person who just wants to end up, you know, retire at 65, sit on the beach, drinking cocktails. It's like the game just never ends. You know, it's just the constant, you know, what can we do next kind of thing.
I mean, I like doing all of those things all at the same time. So I like mixing my life up like that, like you do, you know, lots of free time, you say. I'm always busy and people think I work hard, but I don't feel like it's working hard because I'm just doing what I like doing every day.
Yeah. 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 I'm exactly the same. Like a lot of the time, like I lodge right in a house. The landlord, he's got no idea what I do. Cause sometimes I'll go out and have some food and then I'll sit in the car. I'll be in the car for 2 hours on my phone, like doing emails, doing spreadsheets, reply, making phone calls, you know, and, you know, it's a sort of unconventional kind of, in a way, you know, people that kind of go to work and go to an office, they perhaps don't get it, but yeah, you know, that's, I like that lifestyle.
He thinks you're a drug dealer.
I think he does. I think you're right. That did cross my mind. Because I come in late sometimes. He's like, where have you been? Yeah, but where have you, hang on, you went to the gym 7 hours ago. Where have you been since, you know? But,
especially when you start talking about bringing hemp products in.
So, yeah, you know, the whole, work and life and play and everything is all the same for me as well. And, you know, I like it that way because, I don't really see the downside, really. I mean, I do admire a little bit, like when people go to work and then when they're done and they switch off. I can kind of see that, you know, perhaps that is nice in some ways, but
what does that mean, switch off?
Yeah.
Like, what's the, I don't get it. What are you switching off to? Like, what else is there apart from something exciting to learn or a person to talk to or, you know, I like watching films, of course, but. I have to occupy my time with something. There's too many people who occupy their time or switch off, and they actually do switch off. They sit in front of the TV and watch what's on the TV. Does that make sense? Rather than I love Netflix and TV and movies and things, but only if I've sat down and decided I want to watch this one. Like, it's my decision to do it. It's not,
right. I'm like that with holidays. I don't know if you like traveling and holidays and stuff, but but personally, I'm not into it. I enjoy hustling. I don't want to go anywhere myself. You know, I enjoy my life, my routine, my lifestyle in this country. I like the things I do. I'm quite happy. I don't want to go anywhere. Right. And so, it's funny because sometimes I tell people that, and you know, there's most people find that hard to understand, you know?
Mm. Yeah, I want to go everywhere, but I want to go with a purpose. I don't want to go and sit on a beach and holiday. Like, it's not.
Yeah.
Yeah. I would look for an excuse to go. I've been looking for an excuse to go to Vegas again for a while because I can't think of one. I haven't got a good business reason to go, so I'm not going. So it would have to be connected with something.
Yeah,
like that.
Same. Yeah, but I'd have to feel like I was going to make money or like something come out of it. Like the idea of just going somewhere and it costing a load of money, I can't get my head around that. You know.
Nah. Well, I can't talk about. I have to tell you offline about this.
You're going on an 8-week cruise, are you?
No. About connected to what you just said about can't stand spending money on going on holiday and things. We've got. I think I've got the ultimate solution to it because I do like going away and I've got family all over the world. I've got my sisters in Portugal and we like going to there and I want a little plane one day. I'd love one of my dreams is to have a little plane so I can just a four to six seater so I can go from where we live in Germany back to Wales and to my sisters in Portugal and not have to worry about the travel arrangements, just pick up and go when I want. Yeah. Not the jet. I don't want a jet or anything like that. Just for the freedom of it.
Yeah.
But I can't stand the idea of spending money on a flight or renting a villa or anything, but I think I've got an answer for it.
Oh.
That'll, hopefully satisfy Janina's holiday wishes
and
my business needs.
Nice.
I can't tell you about it. It's such a good idea. I can't get it out on the airwaves.
Okay.
It's so good.
Okay. Yeah. That sounds good.
Coming soon.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, I'm pretty much on the same page with that. Like with my handstand stuff, even though it's only within the UK, I don't go abroad with it. I don't particularly want to, but it's like, I get to travel around and see different towns and meet different people. Yeah. And I make money, not a fortune from it, but you know, I go in with money and I've had a nice day and you know, that suits me.
So what's your next step with that then? So based on what we just said, if we're talking about, is it interesting to you to build that into a business or is it something you're doing?
Do you mean the handstand?
Because you like doing it.
Yeah, no, I'm not looking at that as a long-term moneymaker. I just look at that as kind of just a hobby business. It's something I enjoy doing and I'm not expecting to make big bucks out of that. I'm kind of, I'd rather look towards sort of proper business, towards other business avenues to make proper money from, I think.
Mm. Is there a reason for that? Because, I'll say two things. Because you say I know sometimes you put on Facebook and things like building Circoplex towers and things like that. And I think sometimes you say a lot of stuff just to get a reaction, which is why I think it's so funny to watch some of your posts. But is that, so that's really not because you're not interested in doing it, or because you don't think it will work, or what?
Oh,
because,
good question. You've made me think there. I think there could be scope in that if I wanted to go down that avenue. I'm not exactly sure. I don't know. I think I've got my own personal feelings and mixed feelings in amongst all that as well. I've had an unpleasant time in the circus community. So I think I've got this emotional stuff in that as well. And so, yeah, I'm not sure really. I'm not sure.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Yeah. I think that's there's a business to be had, a great business in almost anything, you know?
Well, I definitely...
Zumba, for example, you know, who would have thought that Zumba could have made billions?
Right. Well, I was definitely on that track. That's really where I wanted to, that was the direction I wanted to go in. I wanted to, my long-term vision was to have sort of bigger and bigger events and retreats and boot camps and festivals and studios and products and, you know, around the, you know, the physical arts and, you know, the acrobatics and hand balancing, all that kind of thing. So yeah, I definitely did have a plan to build something in that thing, but I feel like I've kind of let go of that now. Basically.
Maybe we need to revisit the topic of why, because unless you just sort of said I've let go of it and I don't want to go back to it, that's also fine. But if you think it's because there's not a business there or couldn't figure out the model, then that just might mean you hadn't figured out the model.
Yes. I think you could be right, Chris. Yeah, you got me there. I think I wouldn't rule it out. I think, I hear what you're saying. Mm. Mm.
Hear me now. I don't know why I said that.
Yeah, you got me thinking now.
So did we have something that we were going to talk about today?
Oh, yeah, we were going to talk about stuff, weren't we? we've been talking an hour. Maybe.
No, we haven't.
Yeah, we've been talking an hour.
Because we're going to do some more podcasts about business and strategy and stuff, but we're going to get some guests on.
Yeah.
I always wonder whether, I always loved the idea of having a phone-in show type situation where people would come with challenges and problems to solve. I don't know whether that's something that people would be interested in.
I think that's a great idea. I think that's a fantastic idea. I don't know how it works from a technical standpoint, you know, with people calling in, or whether we sort of pre-arrange, you know, who's going to come on the call.
Yeah, you'd have to pre-arrange it or just get questions submitted. Or
something. Yeah, something like that I think is a great idea. So let's put that intention out there right now. So anyone listening to this, if you've got any business questions, how to grow your business, or you want to talk to Chris or myself, you are welcome to come on the call and we'll do an episode. Is that what you had in mind?
Yeah, let's do it.
Okay, so we can both promote that and sort of on our social media and sort of actively encourage people to come forward and be a guest. If you wanted to do like a regular spot, like the same night every week or something, I'm happy to do that.
I think let's start with a general sort of field of topic of questions, because it could go completely random.
Right.
So maybe we have like themes. Maybe we could start with sales or marketing or business models or partnerships or accounting or something. So where would be? What would be a cool place to start? What general field would be good?
Ooh, yeah. I feel like it's perhaps best if you decide, because it's more your realm, I think. Like, why don't you choose?
All right. Well, let's say sales and marketing.
Okay.
That's a bit broader. So if anyone's got a great idea, a great business that they only wish they could get some more customers for, or they're getting lots of inquiries, but they're not converting them. Or when they meet someone, they buy, but they don't get enough people to meet, to make an inquiry or into their store. those sorts of questions.
Yeah.
With details. You need to give us the details.
Yeah.
Tell us. Yeah. And if you want to come on, if they want to come on and talk about it, that would be even better. But just send the questions.
Oh, yeah. Cool. I love the idea of getting people on the call. Yeah, that you would definitely do that. That's great. Okay, I'll tell you what, we'll leave this one here for now. I can hear my housemates are starting to go to bed probably, so I'll wrap up. Yeah, we'll put that out there and then we'll reconvene with a guest.
Excellent.
Awesome.
Okay, yeah. Cool. All right, Ben and everyone, see you
soon. Thank you, good night.